pause for a word of prayer before we begin. Loving God, for each one who leads us in worship today, we pray that they may be so filled with your Spirit, they will clearly reflect the glory of Christ in all they say and do. We pray that everyone in this place will know you are with us and be drawn to bring you all honor and praise. Amen. I have a few announcements for you. Women's Ministry is looking for several ongoing activities. There was a book club that was started. If you're interested in participating in the book club or any of the other activities that Women's Ministry is talking about, you can call or talk to or text or email Elizabeth Elgin. Maybe some monthly outings. There's lots of cool stuff around that you can go out to see, and great movies are always coming out, and lunch is always fun. So think about what you'd like to do and talk to Elizabeth or Donna Seaman. The next potluck will be a baked potato bar. We'll provide the baked potatoes and you bring the toppings. Think of sour cream, cheese, veggies, bacon bits, chives, salsa, chili, pulled pork.
Oh,
excellent suggestion. Get creative. I hear bacon bits over there. Don't pay attention. Get creative and have a party and fun dinner on October the 4th at 5:30. That's the first Wednesday of next month in room 17. Be there or be square. All of our activities are open to our church family as well as the entire community. If you have friends who might want to come to any of the things that we offer, invite them. Check out our times and places for all our activities on our website. The red pads that are located on the aisle seats are for attendance. If you would print your name legibly and pass it to your neighbor, we would love to know that you are here worshiping with us this morning. And, as always, there will be fellowship after this service down in the Family Life Center. So please take advantage of that. As you are able, let's stand for our call to worship. God calls us to worship.
We come to bring our praise to God.
God calls us to responsibility.
We come to earn our faith to God.
God calls us to responsibility in all our lives.
As God continues, we will strive to be responsible.
Let's now sing our first hymn, All Hail the Power of Jesus. let us confess to God and before one another our sins, and especially the way our irresponsibility dulls our reflection of God's faithfulness. We confess to you, O God, and before one another, that we have sinned. We have given your good creation for us to watch over as your stewards, and we have misused it for our own selfish purposes. We have polluted the air, the water, and the ground of your good earth. We have poisoned the earth and ourselves. You have given us the gift of community, but we have sinned against one another and deprived the peoples of the earth into armed camps. We have not been reflections of your faithfulness, but have instead been reflections of our own irresponsibility. Forgive us and call us once more to being your responsible people who truly reflect your faithfulness. Amen. Through the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, we are forgiven.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
here, Jer. It's you and I. We've made it since July 28, 1945. For 77 years, with lots of smiles and, yes, a few tears, we made it together all those years. At 96 and 95, our family totals 35. And so you see why we're now content to sit and watch the world go by. Please hear our prayer of love and praise to our awesome God for giving us so many happy days. A big thanks to all for the special cards and calls. We're glad you're here with us today, Ida. Let's join together in prayer. Please pray with me. We worship and adore you, our faithful God, for you are the rock of ages who shelters us and preserves us. We offer our thanksgivings to you for all the ways you have acted in faithful caring toward us. We thank you for your spirit that dwells within us and among us, calling us to wholeness and to you. Thank you for those who have been responsible in their dealings with us, so that we learned about your faithfulness. We thank you for this day that dawned bright and glorious and cooler. We pray for each other and for all your creation. We pray for those who have not been responsible for their actions. And we pray for those to be responsible cohabitants of this earth. Many have suffered from violence and abuse. Many have been deserted and forsaken. As you move among them, may our love and care be part of your healing presence. We ask that you intercede in all of the prayer requests spoken aloud, but also those that we keep silently in our hearts. You know our hearts, O God. In all these things we pray through Christ, our only Savior, who has taught us to pray together, saying,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Now let's stand once more as you're able to sing the Solid Rock.
prayer request that I did not get a chance to give to Bill this morning was I had an opportunity to visit Bobby Antholz yesterday. And her mind is very sharp, and she recognizes everybody. But I think that that if you're going to go see Bobby again, you probably want to plan to do it in the near future rather than in the far future. She is hopeful. She is upbeat. And she's really waiting for her granddaughter to come visit her again, which will be next week. So just your prayers, please, for this dear, sweet soul of our congregation, Bobby. I'm going to read to you this morning a strange parable. Jesus Christ himself is talking, and you know the way Jesus is. He's probably surrounded by a multitude of people, including kids and small children and older people and people in between. No doubt there is a crowd surrounding Jesus, and that is when he chooses to say this. I'm going to read to you from the book of Luke at the 16th chapter. Whatever it may mean to us today, here and now, this is the Word of God. Jesus told his disciples that there was a rich man whose manager was accused of wasting his possessions. So he called him in and asked him, "What is this I hear about you? Give an account of your management, because you cannot be my manager any longer." The manager said to himself, "What shall I do now? My master is taking away my job. I am not strong enough to dig. I am ashamed to beg. I know what I'll do. When I lose my job here, people will welcome me into their houses." So he called in each one of his master's debtors. He asked the first, "How much do you owe my master?" 900 gallons of olive oil," he replied. The manager told him, "Take your bill, sit down quickly, and make it 450. Then he asked the second, "And how much do you owe?" 1,000 bushels of wheat," he replied. He told him, "Take your bill and make it 800. The master commended the dishonest manager because he had acted shrewdly. For the people of this world are more shrewd in dealing with their own kind than are the people of light. I tell you, use worldly wealth to gain friends for yourselves, so that when it is gone, you will be welcomed into eternal dwellings. Whoever can be trusted with very little can also be trusted with much. And whoever is dishonest with very little will also be dishonest with much." So, if you have not been trustworthy in handling worldly wealth, who will trust you with the true riches? And if you have not been trustworthy with someone else's property, who will give you property of your own? No one can serve two masters. Either you will hate the one and love the other, or you will be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve both God and money. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Pray with me, please. Give me Jesus, Lord. Give me Jesus. They can have all of the rest. Just give me Jesus. Amen. When's the last time you've been to the movies? Yesterday? Anybody? Day before? Last? meetings yesterday. We had to do some business. Her iPad needs refurbishment, we think. So we went to the Best Buy up in Chandler, and next to that is the Harkins Theater in the Chandler Fashion Mall. Now, if you've ever seen a movie there, you know there's a secret little button that you can push, and your seat goes back. It's like being in a recliner at home. And so, of course, Elizabeth and I, about 25 minutes into the movie, after we'd eaten our fill of popcorn, promptly both of us fell asleep. And we both fell asleep and woke up about the same time, and we looked at each other and we said, "Do you know what's going on?" "No, I was asleep. I don't know what was going on." But I like movies about, for whatever reason, I don't know, I like movies about greedy people. You know, because usually, unlike in real life, in movies, greedy people usually get what they deserve. Now, one of my favorites is Dirty Rotten Scoundrels. Anybody remember that? The incomparable Steve Martin and Michael Caine. Poor Glenn Headley, she hardly ever gets, you know, equal billing. But there are sometimes successful con men whose motivations are dominated by greed. Many Americans take a dim view of greed, even in business. We see movies like Wall Street, in which Michael Douglas's character that says that, in fact, greed is good. But I think we need to differentiate between greed and enlightened self-interest. That latter kind of capitalism has lifted more people out of poverty than any other system in the history of mankind. Now, pure greed, I think we can all agree, is just plain bad. Tony Campolo said that he was at a convention, an insurance sales convention, and he was the keynote. Well, he wasn't the keynote, he was the last speaker. You see, because the company vice presidents, the vice presidents in charge of sales, knew he was a good motivational speaker. He could really rev up the crowd on the way out. Now, I have known my share of insurance salesmen. Some of them are here today, and I think they are a noble breed. They are doing an important job. People in our modern world need insurance, and there are too many unexpected things in life. What Campolo could not believe was the content of these sales seminars. They were teaching the salesmen the art of closing the deal, how to make customers say yes when they really weren't sure, but they had them making decisions for these purchases that would most benefit not themselves, but the company, and even the commission of the salespeople themselves. They were sharing psychological tricks of how to get people to buy things they didn't really need, and how to scare them if they said no. I'm sure all of us have been on the receiving end of something like that, even recently. He listened with increasing frustration until it was finally his turn to speak. Remember, he was the last one. He got up to the podium, he checked the mic, he cleared his throat, and he said, "Everything you have just heard is wrong." He said the vice presidents of the corporation were sitting in the front row where he could see them. And he said to see the blood drain from their faces was pretty entertaining. He said, "Everything you have just heard is wrong. You don't need tricks or gimmicks or pressure to sell insurance. You have something that people need. You provide a vital service." Then he said, "Let me tell you a story." It's a story of a young, poor black preacher who's preaching through the South when things were not easy for African Americans preaching in the South. He was speaking out about the sin of prejudice and segregation and bigotry. And one day, in the crowd was this white, middle-aged insurance salesman who listened to him talk and hear the preacher talk and realize that here is a guy who would be getting death threats given where he was speaking and the surrounding country, and not only against him, but against his entire family. He knew this man needed life insurance. He went up to him after the speech and he said, "Do you have some form of life insurance?" And no, the preacher admitted it's too expensive. "No, it's not," the salesman said. "You are taking a courageous stand, yes, but it's dangerous. You need insurance." The preacher said, "Well, I'll think about it." The salesman made a point of being at the next talk by this preacher, and he found him the next night, and he asked him again afterwards if he had gotten insurance yet. He said no. He told him again, "You need insurance." Now, night after night, this guy began following this preacher around. He badgered him. He bugged him. He wore him down. And finally, the preacher said, "Okay, yes." And he signed a comprehensive life insurance policy. 3 days later, in Memphis, Tennessee, that poor black preacher was standing on the balcony of his hotel when he was shot dead by a bigot. The ministry and life and work of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. was carried on by his family, made in part possible by this insurance policy that he had signed 3 days earlier. So don't listen. Do not listen to what they have been telling you. Everything you have heard here is wrong. You provide a sacred service to a sacred clientele. You should treat them as such. Tony said when he left the podium, he could see that even the vice presidents had tears in their eyes. So you might want to write this down. Do you have a pen? You might want to write this down. I believe in all of its forms you have enough to share, Peter. If you need a pen, ask Peter. Write this down because I think you should know, I believe stealing is wrong. Whether it be a teenager shoplifting someplace or a self-seeking salesperson, I reiterate that in no way do I condone any form of stealing. Despite what Jesus says in our scripture today. Now, as you know, Bill and I have made the 3-year commitment to follow the lectionary. Now, we are about halfway through, and so I stand before you without a choice. I stand before you forced by the Revised Common Lectionary to preach to you on this parable today, one of the most perplexing of Jesus' parables. Now, Jesus tells many strange stories, says author and professor Will Willimon, but this, I think, is his strangest. You know what the Bible seminar is? Now, I don't think they really have a lot of faith in Jesus, but they're scholars, and they go through the Bible, looking at all the red letter words of the Bible, and they, with their scholarly wisdom, decide what they think Jesus actually said, more than what the Bible tells us, what Jesus actually said. And even the Jesus seminar, which doesn't believe much about Jesus, really, even they believe that Jesus told this story. And by the way, well, I don't mean to be critical of you, but this parable was being read, and I was looking out at you, and I saw you there, as I was reading this, and it, as if it makes perfect sense, it makes me wonder about your morality. It certainly makes me question mine. You see, to heck with morality, Jesus was on a roll. You hear the one about the rich man who heard that his manager was stealing from the company? He comes in and says, "Show me the books, you thief." And the manager responds, "The book? Sure, just give me a few moments to make some notations. I'm too proud to beg. Too lazy to do honest work," the manager says. "I've got to find a way out of this." And the swindle
master's creditors
and customers. And how much do you owe my master? 1,000? Let's drop a zero off that. You only owe 100. Hey, how do you like that? Hey, 4 million? No, look at this. Thanks to my efforts, you only owe 400. Huge sums are written off so that when the master finally fires the little thief, he can go to his debtors and say, "Remember me? I'm the guy who helped you cheat my former boss." The next day, the boss calls the crook in and he says, "Okay, show me the books." The manager presents the ledger. You can still see the parts that have been scratched out and erased and written over, the thoroughly cooked books. And the master says, "What, you thief? You crook, you're stealing from me?" No, he says, "You genius. You business genius. I wish all of my guys showed the initiative, showed the ambition, the worldly wisdom, creative, the commercial creativity that you showed. You are one shrewd servant. Now I'm moving you up to the front office." I'm sure the people in the crowd were saying, "Jesus, what are you saying? Come on. Come on, there are young people here, Jesus." They would turn each other in the crowd and say, "He can't be serious about telling this story, can he? Surely he must have delivered this parable with a wink of the eye." In the original, surely Jesus ended with, "Just kidding. We all know that stealing is prohibited in the Ten Commandments. Boys and girls, if you actually model yourselves on this story, the feds will come and take you away. Of course, I'm only joking." No, Jesus does not say that. Though Jesus should have ended this parable with a disclaimer, what he says was his master commended the dishonest manager. "For the children of this age are more shrewd than are the children of the light. And I tell you, make friends for yourselves by means of dishonest wealth." Jesus, what are you talking about? Can you feel what a burden it is for Jesus to have forced me to try to relate this parable to you? I'm a child of the light, I swear it, I am, with a good deal of enlightened theological education to tell this story, praising immoral children of this age to fellow children of the light like you? You aren't in the majority by being here in church today, by the way. You know, the majority of people in Casa Grande remain in bed this morning. I know halfway through your sermon, you're probably going, "I should have done that too." See, that's why we are good church-going Christians, and we're called, among other things, instead of children of the light, the people who stay home are children of this age. They're more shrewd. Their morality is more of a worldly vision of morality. The go-along to get-along values of today. But you, unlike them, you got up, you got dressed, you got to church, certifying you as the closest thing in Casa Grande to children of the light. And some of you are expecting right now that I'm going to say, "Relax. You can all thank God that when faced by a perplexing parable like this one, you are in the hands of a qualified professional with an advanced degree in interpreting Jesus, and he didn't really mean to commend the dishonest manager. It's just first century Near Eastern Semitic hyperbole. In Greek, klepto doesn't really mean steal. It means borrow, sort of. Well, forget it. I know that you children of the light would love me to pull out a little historical critical sleight of hand in order to get Jesus to say something than what he clearly said.
Believe me, if there was a way to get out of this outrageous, ill-considered, perplexing parable, those who have gone before, the historical critics, far smarter than I, would have delivered it by now. So while I hate to see Jesus disappoint me, would you just consider the possibility that Jesus is much more about more important matters than even helping you to be a better person? Maybe Jesus is not going to wait until you get your books cleaned up and you are certified a better person before he loves you and takes delight in you. And even when the best that can be said about you is your questionable ethics are true, you have to love a Savior who would dare tell a story like this to children of the light like you and me. How odd it is of Jesus to insult our godliness by commending this guy's badness with all our serious, moral, uplifting, important political, economic, and social issues before us. Why would Jesus waste this holy day with his unholy kid? Come over here. You're the one about the boss who had this little creep of a manager, and let's be honest. Despite our best intentions, besides our earnest efforts and our pretensions, most of us, more than we like to admit, are children of this age. More than we are children of the light. We want to move forward into the light, but then there are these shady urges, these secret habits, the things we think and do when nobody is watching. Some of the things we did last night after the party don't look so good now in the light of Sunday church. And we pledge our allegiance to the kingdom of heaven, but the kingdoms of this world own us. You've got to love a Savior who doesn't mind getting mixed up every now and again with some of us low-life children of this age, even to allow us to nail him to a cross. So determined was he to love us as we are, rather than who we think we should be. You have to love a Savior with a gentle, amused appreciation for the antics of the children of this age. Only a Savior like that could save sinners like me. So why did Jesus tell this story? I don't know. Really, I've thought about this for years, and I don't know. But then I have had many decades of working with children of the light, and something about church can mislead us into thinking that when Jesus says, "I've come to save the sick and the sinners," that he's not actually talking about you and me. But if by chance there is somebody here who is a card-carrying member of the children of this age, somebody better at being shrewd than being good, then maybe you can hear this story differently for the rest of us supposed good ones. Maybe you will thrill when the master tells you and calls in somebody who's a lot worse than you, and he says, "Well done, shrewd servant. Sometimes I tire of these goody-two-shoe children of the light with their moral pretensions. I can use more shrewd wheeler-dealers like you." How dare Jesus delight in forcing a preacher like me to deliver a message like that to people like you. William Barclay said he believes that's the entire point of the parable. That if we, and the energy and the passion and the ability that we have in our everyday lives, if we apply that to furthering the kingdom of God, the kingdom of God on earth as it is in heaven, we would be a lot further along in the way of the creation of God's kingdom on earth. So through the ages, there have been those who have accused the Christian faith of being passive. A pie in the sky by and by when you die philosophy that has nothing to do with the here and now. But because we believe that God is in charge of the future, why should we busy ourselves with the work of the church today? And of course, that is a grotesque caricature of the gospel. In reality, things are just the opposite. Because we know the future is in God's hand, because we are confident that He is working to reconcile the world to Himself, we should be filled with boldness. We can move out into a future with great confidence, with great vitality, free to act in outrageously creative ways, because we are free from the anxiety about how it ends. We Christians, we cheat. We go to the end of the book and we find out we win. Jesus wins. Every knee shall bow. Every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Christian activist Jim Wallace noted a sober fact. How many deaths occur among drug lords who are fighting for their turf, their share of the drug market? Wallace says he wants congregations to get more aggressive about their turf, to say to drug lords and other peddlers of death and drugs and child exploitation, this is our turf. We control this neighborhood for the six blocks around our church. And we are going to do just about anything necessary to make sure you do not trample our turf. See, God's kingdom means that God claims us and this world as God's turf. We Christians need to be bolder in naming that divine claim and in protecting it. Dick Powell addressed a Faith Alliance meeting on this campus earlier this week, and I had a chance to spend about an hour and a half with him. I never had that kind of personal FaceTime with him before. But Dick told me the story of a time several years ago when people of faith, the children of the light, got together to confront gangs that were coming into Casa Grande from Los Angeles. See, the city and the city council approached the churches, especially the black churches, and they told them who these thugs were and what they represented and what they wanted to do to their neighborhoods and their children. And these children of the light got together and educated their congregations, and they told them, they told these gangs to get out. The children of the light were not going to stand for it. It seems like what we need to do is that in our churches today. Educate our children and ourselves about what it means to be children of the light, not children of this age. To fight for unity, not diversity. To fight for peace, not injustice. To protect our turf for the kingdom of Jesus Christ. May May we put the time and the effort into being shrewd servants. Servants of the light. Pray with me, please. Almighty God and Heavenly Father, what if everything we have heard up to this point is wrong? What if only you can bring us the light? What if you are calling us to a greater participation in the building of the kingdom? Heavenly Father, I ask your blessing upon this congregation, these children of the light here gathered to follow your word, to bless you. Show us your ways, Heavenly Father. It is in Jesus Christ's name that we pray. Amen.
Let us give thanks to the Lord with all our being. In the company of the upright, let us honor God for the blessings and goodness we have received. Ushers, please come forward and receive the morning offering.
Do that, know that you are blessed by God the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Ghost, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Jesus.